last time, it can't be that big of a focus with one extra champion removed here. Maybe that is, like, maybe there's actually just enough strain in the champ pool, but with things like Nidalee still available, like Yasuo, Twisted Fate, like all
these, you'd have
like,
to make a comp around it, yeah.
Yeah, but Jax was the one ban that wasn't grabbed there by Chantel Macthao that does go to JWoww, who helped carry the end game last time. Now, I know Renekton fell out of favor, but that's a traditional counter pick to Jax. If that comes in for Vanez, he does play it. Like, this would be, in my opinion, a smart pick if you want to say, look, let's crush our lanes, let's push through, close the game in 30 minutes.
Exactly. And that might be the style that they go for here for Chantel Macthao. We had to see what they do in that 1-2 spot. But overall, they have a lot of options open here in terms of how to exploit the playstyle of Gamers 2. Previously, didn't go so well. They kind of played like a mid-game comp with Teamfight.
Yeah. And they couldn't find teamfights.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Couldn't do anything.
And that, a lot of that was actually, to be fair, on the point of Gamers 2, the static Shiv second by Yuki. He got ahead because of the kill in the lane that allowed him to grab BT Shiv early, but every time SMW tried to push, they were stopped by Jinx, and they couldn't find ways to split up and go to a second turret in time, you know, quickly. But some of that was Gamers 2 stopping some of those mid-game pushes, but still, I agree, SMW just couldn't find the moves there. So Satain will go back to that Kha'Zix pick. This time Thresh will go to Saze. We'll see if that's some more playmaking they can kind of capitalize on, but it leaves a lot more good champions on the table.
They're going to go ahead and get themselves same champion that Satain played. And look at that. Immediately, Morgana comes out against the Thresh.
We could see a mirror match at the bottom lane this time, where it's now Gamers 2 playing Morgana Lucian and potentially Thresh Jinx there for Chantel Macthao. Problem is, Jinx sucks a little bit against Jax. Like, you're really auto-attack reliant, and the guy dodges for a living. So that would be a risky pick here, depending on how much they can support him with, but we'll see what the grabs end up being. I mean, you could still go for Ori Shyvana and just try to go for these all-in dives and play it a bit better. But I want to see.
Yeah, another thing that's a little bit overlooked is that the amount of shots that you dodge during Counter-Strike actually increases the damage up to 100%. So you actually increase Jax's damage if you were trying to deal damage to him with auto-attacks while he's using his Counter-Strike.
It's pretty scary overall, and I've heard some people call it a 2-second fear, actually, because you just run away from Jax for the 2 seconds, because you can't attack him.
That's true.
That'll run away. It's a 2-second fear and a 1-second stun. A pretty strong ability. So Jinx does come through. It's actually Irelia for the top end of this one. Irelia versus Jax is a very interesting matchup. Basically, whoever hits a button first loses. If you turn on Heaten style before they hit Counter-Strike, you lose.
Yep.
If you turn on Counter-Strike before they hit Heaten style, you lose. So you have to play around that.
They kind of provoke each other.
Yeah.
So you basically sit there and hit nothing and hope that you have an advantage in items or something happened early game for you to the point you force them to make the first.
Basically, it's the battle of the passive. The W passive versus the Jax ulti passive. And whoever can get more out of it is going to do better. Nidalee does come through here for Ocelot. The team's actually pretty good on the back line. You got Morgana to keep him safe. Jax can counter engage. Lee Sin can kick back. G2 very good at kiting back. A new comp for these guys. But with how safe they play, this makes more sense for the play style.
Yeah, Gamers too, they can turtle it out and have Ocelot and JWoww just sit there chucking spears and then engage the fight with the Jax, who's extremely scary in the late game.
Yep.
Now they have two. They have the Lee Sin and Lucian to bully the early game, keep themselves safe there.
Ooh.
Try to close it out that way.
This is going to be fun, though. Chantel Macthao going for an aggressive sort of play style. I like this a lot because I think it strikes to the heart of what Chantel Macthao needs to do. Cinder comes into the mid lane, which can bully run Nidalee, and I think Avenue won his lane last time. He can win it even harder with this matchup. And then you're like, you got hooks to catch, you've got Cinder to catch, you can follow up with Jax, Irelia, and Jinx rockets. You've got a lot of ways of picking up a kill and then going for it. Jinx is one of the best turret sieges in the game if you've got a numbers lead, if she's safe, which you can be with a Thresh. Chantel Macthao's lineup could work very well this game.
Yeah, they traded bottom lanes. See who plays it better. Maybe they will end up on Gamers 2 having the zero in the kills and assists instead of the deaths.
See.
But on the overall, though, very mixed compositions here for both of them. They have late game presence.
True.
But they both have some early game, too.
Yeah. Both top laners can turn this game by themselves. If either top lane wins super hard, Irelia can take over, Jax can take over. I think Jax is more likely to take over in general, but that matchup can flip based on ganks. And in game one, we saw better gank presence from Satain, the jungler of Chantel Macthao. So my initial thought is that tips the favor in the way towards SMW because you can tip that matchup and win it outright because they're fighters. There's no fallback pattern, really. But I do have to see how well the bot lane goes. Right. We've flipped the matchup. We said before Lucian Morgana wins the 2v2. I agree, as champions.
Yes.
And yet, even still, Yuki and Dude won with a disadvantage matchup. Now they got the favored matchup, and I want to see, is that even more brutal here? I know you mentioned during the post-game of Game 1, what is SMJ just lane swap? They just switch the lanes around, dodge the matchups, keep JWoww down in a, you know, he's like farming by himself as a Jax. He's going to be kind of afraid. He's not in a lane just yet. Like, there's definitely ways for Shantae MoxVal to out-strategically play their opposition, play their comp out, and then siege and win.
Yeah, it's a little difficult, though, because Dragon is worth more gold right now than it was previously. So they'd be giving up a little more. So they had to get more out of the lane swap than they typically would.
Yeah.
So the thing here is that this matchup between these two teams is very volatile.
Yeah.
If there's a point of action that a jungler pays attention to, or if there's a solo lane kill, it's very hard to get tabs back on it because of the two teams here and their play styles.
Very true.
So once somebody gets a lead that's about 3,000 gold, I would expect it to just keep getting bigger and bigger. Because nobody's super aggressive. Nobody's making a lot of plays. They're just waiting for the team to outplay themselves.
The weird thing is, though, like with both these team comps actually promote you making a choice to do something active around 20 minutes into the game. For gamers too, it's start the siege either when Athene's comes in, or even Athene's death cap, or even Athene's like needlessly large rod. But you get some items in Ocelot, and the siege can start. Right? Yuki can deal good turret damage and whatnot. They should be all right. Seitain, very happy about this game.
Bah!
I think it's hilarious. That's fine.
At least he's all laughs right now.
Yeah. But while Gamers 2 wants to siege around 20 minutes,
he doesn't even care about that word.
It's true. He's laughing at it. And now Gamers 2 thinks it's funny as well. But Shantae MoxVal, like, they've got to actually do something. I think 25 minutes in, if they get a lead, press really hard. Use your assassins and dive in, because they don't have a tank until 45 minutes. So they've got to find these offhand jungle fights, these invades, these three-on-threes, and take advantages.
Lane swap here from Gamers 2.
Wow.
They're actually going to forfeit dragon control in the early game. First
weapon ever. I think they're looking for it. Because keep in mind, right?
They think it'll happen.
I think they do, because think about it, right? Shantae MoxVal sought the matchup in Game 1. They saw the ward, still got spotted, and went for it.
Speaking of outplaying yourself.
Yep. This is definitely Mind Games won by Shantae MoxVal.
Now, there could be the chance that Gamers 2 want the lane swap instead of trying to find it. But we'll have to see. The thing, though, is that they saw that Seitain was starting on the left side of the jungle, so you would assume that that's where the AD carry is going to be.
Yeah, you typically start... This is actually the interesting thing as well, is there is a possibility that Shantae MoxVal gets a 3-buff start here. If they play it right, the duo lane can get control of the bottom side red buff, bring Kha'Zix in, and steal red, then get their own blue. Like, there's a lot of ways that Shantae MoxVal, they didn't get punished at all for the level one setup, and could really get 3 buffs here if they play it right.
JWoww just leaves the lane, abandons it, goes, becomes an honorary jungler for a little bit. It's graced by Morden.
Yeah, right now, Sayz should be at the red buff, putting a ward down. Like, there's no reason for Sayz not to be in there trinketing this red and pulling Seitain and Vanez down. Turns out that the greedy play by Shantae MoxVal doesn't get punished, but they could have gotten more for it.
Yeah, and there's always the chance here that you, because you don't know where the top laner is, you don't know where the jungler is, you didn't ward up, they could go mid right now and blow a flash. They could get a gank, or most likely they're going to go bottom and try to defend the turret, but there's always that possibility, and you always have to be aware of those types of things. You want as much information as possible.
Yeah.
It's basically what it comes down to.
Well, we'll see. I mean, Morden and JWoww, honestly, a very strong gank duo. You've got a Jax and a Lee Sin, both of whom have big power spikes level 2 here. Looks like right now they're not going to punish the Syndra just yet. Just wave clear so far for Avenue. He's actually equal in CS to Ocelot. Hasn't bullied him out just yet. Seitain and Vaan is going to make their way across the map. They do not get spotted by any wards. And right now, they're just kind of trying to live in the jungle. Trinket Ward will let them go for the Wraith camp here.
It's the mid gank here from Morden and JWoww. They're going to come around the immobile Syndra.
Ooh, Avenue is not in a good spot right here. This is super risky for Avenue. If he goes to the south, he can join his team for a 3-on-3. He needs to go that way right now. Nice knockback. The two-man stun. Javelin will hit. Also brings him to half.
They aren't expecting this.
They could have waited longer. He could have baited that. He could have baited that by running right into the brush and maybe catching Ocelot. Not the case here. Shantae MoxVal do keep their mid laner safe, but he lost some health.
Man, I only thought one team was going to go mid and try to gank it, but they both end up coming there. Look at that. Now, you'll be relegated to farming the jungle again. This is actually going to cause a very slow game to happen. Because everybody's going to have extra gold, be a little more accelerated. Whoever the dragon goes over to, if they don't push that advantage, then shame on them. But look at that.
Oh, good damage, though. Nice. I like the coordination there. Hook into chompers in front, and then he flays them onto the chompers. They have practiced that combo before, and they played it perfectly.
They just had to play against it, too.
Yeah, true.
Like, that's a great combo. If you're going to pair anybody with Jinx, it's Thresh. But up against Lucian Morgana, it's not that great.
Agreed completely. We're going to see how they can play around that right now. 31 to 28 in minions. Gamers 2 pushing a little bit slower.
Vantage has an advantage here in terms of levels and CS over JWoww.
And this bot lane turret's going to take a lot of damage. Morden actually forced to defend right there. Good damage comes through Morden. He's level 4. Will they go for the Shantou? Takes a turret shot. That is not good. Oh my god, Sage just did as well. The health bars are low enough. Gamers 2 could win a 2-on-2 here.
Well, here's the thing, is that Satane isn't top with Vanez. So it's a 2-on-1. And he's farming his jungle. He's not doing anything on the map in terms of pressure.
Yeah, and there was a threat that he could counter gank as well. So no dive comes through. Bottom lane turret will drop right here. Chantal Machtvau, they're going to deny as many minions as possible. They do take it out, and they're actually going to clear this wave. This is interesting to me because it's going to actually put the wave in a really bad spot where it's going to push in unless they push a lot harder.
Yeah, they didn't get the top turret just yet for Gamers 2. Sitting around, Vanez is going to help farm the jungle again. A lot of that CS that he's actually accumulated for himself are tiny little wraiths.
Yeah, true.
Tiny little wolves. And now no move for the dragon, actually, by either team.
Well, Satan's got to heal first, but right now, if these guys do recall, they could definitely go for a five-man dragon and use that right as Gamers 2 goes for top lane turret. That's an absolute completely available play right here for SMW.
And it looks like they're actually just going to keep Yuki in the top lane by himself. Dude is coming bottom to stop this, because Shantou MacDowell, they're getting a little greedy here with this play.
Well, the thing is, so is Gamers 2, actually. Yuki's alone freezing the top lane to deny even more minions, which allows Shantou MacDowell to play a 5-on-4 in the rest of the map. But the mid lane is there, it's a 4-on-3. They could do more.
But Satane's doing nothing. He's farming his jungle.
Well, they're going to look for a tier 2 turret. Does not have the extra damage reduction bonus, so some damage will come through here. This is a 2-on-3. There's the ping finally onto Dragon. Mid laner got pushed out. Also, it's under his turret right here, so Avenue in a decent spot for this one, and now they can make the move.
All right, Vanez is coming down for the Dragon as well. And now Yuki has no possible way of getting to this fight in time.
Wow, the fact that the ward came down scares the team away, though, despite the 4-on-5.
That's crazy. They know it's a 4-on-5, too. They're just very scared of it, not very bold.
Also, it's got no mana. Like, you can't throw more than, like, 2 javelins.
Yeah. Avenue, taking it to him once again, was able to back and get himself an item. Oh, there's
javelin
the gank.
Javelin hits, he flashes. Dude, not going to land the Q in this one. And Ocelot, despite being the one pushed under his turret, 9 minions up on Ocelot right here. So, got to say, that mid lane matchup working very, very well for the Nidalee player. And it's... You know, it's a 700 gold lead right now for Shantou MacDowell, but that's only because of the turret kill. Otherwise, the game is neck and neck.
Yeah, and they had a back for Avenue early, where he gave up a lot of CS. And he's going to catch up now, but he got the early chalice, and now the back from Ocelot gets in the chalice and the Doran's Ring and boots. So definite item advantage here. And actually, Avenue's going to get his own back. Timing it pretty well.
The recall stopped by Dude. And, oh, I thought they're going to freeze the lane. They're not. Ocelot's going to actually push as fast as he can with this one happening. Blue buff coming up in a second. They could have frozen that wave just for a short time and denied the full next wave away from Avenue, but, you know, it still might work out quite nicely if he does get the shove going in.
Yuki, best top laner in the Challenger Series.
There you go. 69 minions. He's number one in the game right here. Vanez is waiting around on the wings, but it's level 5 versus level 6. Attempt 2. Nope.
Nope. Go for 3.
Yay! Yeah.
Third time's a charm. By that time, he could have walked around. But still.
But it looks more stylish this way.
Yeah.
I got to say, it's very thematic that Ocelot is playing Nidalee, being that they're both cats.
Yeah, I can see the connection. Ocelot form for him.
Yep.
Oh?
Ocelot
in the bush
Nidalee.
Here,
right, please.
JWoww.
All right, good play there. JWoww jumps back to the minions. He's going to be safe. Level 6 on this Jax. We still have not seen him in a duel against anyone just yet. 40 minions on him, though, is a decent clip. He's actually now ahead of Vanez in this one, who still is not level 6 on Aurelia. So Gamers 2 is starting to get a lot better out of these matchups. Top lane turret still has not fallen. Chantou, though, gets rooted up. This could be dangerous for him. Where's the lander coming in? He does not quite have one. It's going to be a big burst of damage. First blood goes over to JWoww's Jax as well. That's a good head start.
It's a good first blood there. Camping in the bush, waiting for him to ward it, knowing that he wanted that vision. then they end up getting some turret damage for it too. They didn't actually get the top tier one turret at all.
Yeah, Yuki just did not try for it whatsoever. They'll get it at some other point down the line, but it's 100 gold everyone else is missing. Bot lane outer will drop for this one, so Gamers do making the move, and here we go. They're going to deny some of this. Man, they're really playing the denial game.
Yeah. It's kind of reminiscent of All-Stars.
Yeah.
When you get fast pushed, you're just like, no, we'll just farm. It's fine. Go ahead and counter it.
It definitely shows their style. They're happy to take all the time they want with these advantages to deny as many players as possible. Turret does go down. Jigsawker comes out. We'll spot this dragon. JWoww's recall will stop, and Gamers 2 get the dragon for themselves. Nice binding's going to stop the Jinx there as well. That will give some more time for Vana to push the top lane. And actually, they might just catch something here. Yuki forced a flash away in that one, so a couple of summoners lost.
Catches a flash for his trouble. Now, I gotta say, Satane, his early game presence was non-existent.
It's the two-on-one lanes. There's not
but
much.
The two-on-one lanes, the jungler, Morden, was in a lane.
True.
And Satane didn't do anything. He farmed his Wraiths. He farmed his White. His CS is only 5 above Morden's. His level, he's up a little bit. But at the same time, he didn't help his top laner keep off the siege. He didn't come bottom and push it even harder. He didn't go for dragon until it was too late, and Morden had already done his job of babysitting JWoww.
Yeah, I think you're right about that.
There was a lot of places to just exploit, and he didn't do it.
Speaking of exploitation, Gamers 2 showing up in the mid lane with their AD carry. Good damage from this turret right here. Satane shows up and takes skill shots. He's going to be going down. Wow, not the place he wanted to be. Nice capitalization by Gamers 2.
Satane in the wrong spot gets caught by a binding. Now they're going to get this turret off of it. Gamers 2, they might not have to play that really long game anymore.
Well, and they're equipped to close the game out, though. Again, they're not facing against Nidalee. They're not facing against this wave clear Lucian. Until Static Shift comes out, Jinx doesn't really have great clear. So there's a lot of chances here. Gamers 2 now making their way up to the
they're
top
going
lane
for
as
Vanas
well.
Here.
They're trying for it. Mord's going to have some decent damage there. Lance the slow is going to kick Vanas back in, but it's going to make JWoww miss the stun. However, this turret's going to be going down. You're going to get rid of that one real quick, and now Vanas has nowhere to go. Still running through the brush. They make the play.
Oh!
Yeah, oh, jumps the minion to the lantern! Not quite going to be there in time. Ocelot lands the javelin, and down he goes. Now the Morgana ult is going to land this on this one as well. They will land the stun onto Sage. He did not need to flash. He was definitely going down anyway. Box comes out, and down goes another kill. Gamers 2, 4-0.
Yeah, now they have a 4,000 gold lead. They got the first dragon. They got a lot of kills from some. They have all of the outer turrets, and they're Nidalee, though. They can siege this up so easily.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome, these guys, and they're going to keep trying on this one with just the Chalice and Double Thorns. They're going early on this one. Bloodthirst from the AD carry is all they needed to do.
That was
a nice binding. Avenue losing half his health. Of course, Black Shield keeps the Morgana safe. Avenue forced a flash away from JWoww. Flash Q would have been the death of him here. So top lane tier 2, they're taking plenty of damage. A new mini wave shows up to reinforce, and this damage still continuing. Going to be 4 champion kills plus 4 turret kills. Even Yuki's able to defend the mid lane. So just so much gained for Gamers 2.
Chantal Max, wow, look completely disorganized right now.
And Gamers 2 look completely different from last
game.
Yes,
they do.
They
got
so
that
many
early advantage, and I think they felt out their opponent of Shanta Maxvao, and they know how to play against it. Play against their style. There's a lot of things in SMW's play that you can just be like, oh, they didn't punish us for that, so we can make mistakes.
Yeah, it's worked so beautifully now for Gamers 2.
But they haven't made any.
Yeah, they really haven't. You're right. They're playing pretty much perfectly here in this one. About a 5,000 gold lead now for Gamers 2. 13 minutes in. What a substantial lead on this one. Satane just doing what he can to stay up in his jungle. He is actually a level up on Morden, but that doesn't really mean too much when your team's up this much gold.
Because he was farming so much and not sitting in the lanes along top lane or bottom lane. So Morden had to split a lot of EXP.
Yeah. And Morden now has the Sight Stone to continue to rest ward control over the map. You can see a ton of blue wards at the top side of the map. Although they're not going to use the top lane very much anymore. It's more going to be mid and bot for the extra 2 turret kills. We're going to see how much more they can push forward.
Satane just bought a red pot, a fort pot for himself. He knows he's behind it and he's going to try to make a play. It's something he should have been doing a long time ago.
True. Well, they're going to do what they can. Right. All these wrongs. Dude. Trying to get ward control. You can see now this blue buff pretty well owned by G2. Pink ward in the brush, going to keep Avenue a little bit safe, but he still takes the binding. Satane looks for the play to make, though. He sees that the blue buff is up, and here comes Yuki, though, to turn this one back around. Satane not in the right spot. He went a little bit too aggressive with that one, made the play, and that play was him dying. Blue buff goes over to Yuki on this one, and now they can go to the bottom lane.
Just great capitalization here by Gamers 2. It's definitely not going to be as long a game as it was previously. They've corrected some of their mistakes, and they are punishing all the ones that SMW made. Don't look as nervous.
You're right, they don't at all. They look completely on form. They're taking all the advantages, setting up the wards and going for the buff right away, and no one's been there to stop them. So here we go. Mid lane could be the next target very easily. 15 minutes in. 6,000 gold lead. Vaughn is trying to hold on to this top lane. Doesn't even have half of the Trinity Force right now, whereas Ruin King is already done for JWoww. So that power spike's already done. Athene's Sork Shoes is already there for Ocelot. Bloodthirster, you guys haven't bought since they were sieging the top lane. He's got probably 1,200 gold in the inventory at the very least in this point.
Oh, yeah.
At least there. Sage walks over a trap. JWoww's got to be a bit careful. Nice play to knock him back. Good stun there as well. Good burst comes through. They do drop down JWoww. Nicely done right there by Avid and the rest of the team. Shantan Machval, can they defend the 5v4?
It's a strange moment of hesitation there for JWoww. Still had his flash. Didn't have vision of the bush, but ended up doing nothing. Just getting hooked, allowing himself to be taken out. And now we have to see what Shantan Machval does with that, because there's 20 seconds, 25 seconds until the dragon is up. They're going to clear this bottom wave, get it for themselves, and start that one pushing. So there's something that has to be dealt with by gamers too. But both teams last game looked like they were playing to not lose.
Yeah.
This game, gamers too, looks like they're playing to win.
They really do. And they're doing a very good job of that one. I mean, one catch, not the end of the world for this one.
And I think it's really Morden and Dude who have stepped up in this one. Dude is making a lot of catches for his team.
Yeah.
And Morden is playing very aggressive now.
Yeah.
Been involved in 80% of the kills, going in, and Ocelot, you know, he can play as safe as he wants to. He doesn't have to make an aggressive play. He just pokes, and he's fine. The rest of his team will do it for him.
Well, he's been landing the javelins. Gamers 2 are kind of ground, but Dragon's going to be started out by Shantan Machval. Good damage on Evidence to start this one out. Dragon very low on health. The Q comes out. Vina's got to be careful. The play is going to miss, and down goes the kill. It's Dragon for one kill. Shantan was in a bad spot. Flashed over. JWoww's going to chase him down. Going to be 2-0 so far. 3-0. The kills keep on coming in. Sazed. Gonna drop as well, make that one 4, and now it's gonna be everybody falling over. The double kill for Ocelot and the ace for Gamers 2.
Well, looked like it was the test for Shantan Machval, and they got aced.
Yes.
In response to Gamers 2, they're gonna go straight for this Baron now.
All right, wow, 16 and a half minute Baron. They're not, I mean, the pre-spawn timers are so short, sure, they're gonna go for this one instead.
He comes straight in, he ends up kicking Satane and kills top laner at the same time Vanas goes down. They just split them off again. SMW, every time they get in a dragon fight, they kind of scatter. It's like every man for himself.
Uh-oh, Mord's got to be careful.
Oh.
Heal by Ocelot saved his life. They're taking so much damage here. Summoner heal burned as well. Vaughn is not going to be there in time, though. Scumbag JWoww didn't even help his team for that one, but they do get the Baron Nashor picked up at 17 minutes. So 9,000 gold Gamers 2 very, very far ahead.
Yeah, Vanez, 40 CS behind JWoww. JWoww was winning the laning phase previously as Aurelia versus Shyvana in the last game. And man, JWoww as a top laner, he loves those scaling champions, but he plays the early game well. So he gets them.
Yeah, he does. He's been doing great in lane, great in the early to mid game fights as well. Every single time, gotta say I'm impressed with him. Mid lane turret will go down. Shantan Machval capitalize on the recalls of Gamers 2 and get something back. But they've got a long way to go if they're to win this game and stay alive in this series. Gamers 2, they've got Baron buff. They've been playing aggressively all game. How good will the siege be?
Do the laundry, wash dishes, and pay some bills.
Jinx is no fun.
No fun at all.
Right?
Yeah, it's Fishbones doing that. So the thing here is this deathless bottom lane. If Shantan Machval walk away with anything, at least kill the bottom lane.
Yep.
One time. Kill Yuki or kill Dude.
Any of them.
That's all you need to do. Gamers 2 will forfeit.
No, unlikely.
They won't, but
they will be a little bit sad
that
they'll miss their 4 deathless
my
game.
KDAs! My KDAs!
Actually, KDA wouldn't even get dropped with one
death. That's true.
They could each die once.
Yeah, because we don't. But their combined bottom lane KDA would
then it would go down.
Oh, cut in half.
So what? Can't do it.
See if they have it in them.
I don't think I've ever seen 100 KDA before. And they're on track for it.
Yeah, that's true. It's very true.
That'd be an impressive number.
They would end up playing in the next round the winners of the previous one, NIP.
Yeah.
Who have Freeze and Mythi.
Good luck with that one.
Yeah.
They're pretty strong lane.
Former Worlds players.
Pretty strong.
Ocelot, former World player.
Freeze didn't go to Worlds.
That's true. Former LCS. Yeah. Oh!
Oh, Avenue gets knocked back in. The stun comes in for JWoww. That's going to be a nice kill picked up. Well played there by Morden for the flash kick on this. Stompers come out. Ocelot actually eats them there. Big damage because he's got to be careful. There's the shutdown picked up. But Yuki's been pushing the mid lane there. That's going to be a turret killed. One for one in the fight overall.
And they end up getting that middle tier 2 turret. And now they can go ahead and roam around. And they're going to collapse on Vanez here.
Vanez bit off a little more than Yukichu. He's going to flash back into the game. But a great Flark binding's going to kill pick one up. Morden gets the kill credit. Jaywell hooked now inside the base. But it's still a 4 versus 3. They're actually going to go for this one. Yuki putting some good damage down. Dio helping as well. Lands the bind on a Shantou. They're not going to go for this one, though. Jaywell, first one away from that one, despite the bind on the AD carry.
The bind was so good. It was a flash there by Vanez to the other side of Dude, and he reacted instantaneously with the binding.
Yeah, I wonder if he was like aiming for Sazed and got it anyway. But
yeah,
either way,
or aiming
awesome
for the lantern. Anybody who takes this,
gonna get binded. Worked out really well, I gotta say. That's all I care about. So, Trinity Force now done for Vanez. It's a bit of a power spike. Brutalizer for Satan. He is trying to contribute damage to these fights, but 0-3-1, he is very, very far behind. The makings of a death cap for Avenue can maybe turn this fight around if there's no defense, but you've got that item pretty much done now for Ocelot, so he's in a good spot. 2.5 items for Yuki on AD carry, like, that was cool.
Yeah.
Oh, he missed one.
Ah. That's still one of the most fun ways to kill a wave.
Yeah, it is.
It's just so great. It feels awesome when you pull it off. You're like, oh, I'm really ahead. Mm-hmm. Oh, nope, I'm not. I just have Trinity Force.
I just kill minions really well. Gotta say though,
Satan trying to flank from the side here.
He's looking for the play, but all of Gamers 2 is around.
Jumps up, let's
do this.
Ping,
they know.
Satan!
He dodges the E, gets the lantern. Alright. But just think about how much Gamers 2 has done before the Shiv got done for Shantou. Like how well they were able to stop any of this defense, keep the siege going, and just keep finding the picks. It's really impressively done.
Split push coming out here with the teleport from JWoww. There's no way that Vanez could actually fight him because his flash is down, so he has no escape. Especially since he's Aurelia. You have to play some nice little jukes around the minion wave.
Ooh. Oh, man.
That's what he gets for laughing.
Right.
Spear right in his gullet.
Aw. Poor guy. Wow, Vanez losing a lot of health as well. It's a lot of damage coming out from Ocelot 21 and a half minutes in. No one's even started to buy defensive items yet. Like, that's how far ahead he is. He's just...
That's 21 minutes.
It's completely above the curve, yeah. JWoww going through the play on a Shantou. Good damage through. Flame Choppers are there. Good flash keeps him a bit safer.
Ooh.
Does dodge the Javelin on the way out, but Gamers 2 barely take damage.
Very, very close Javelin there. That's what Ocelot's just going to continue to do. He almost has the death cap completed, but they've already got themselves in a position where they're so far ahead. They basically have 125% of the gold, the enemy team. 130%-ish.
Yeah, they're up a third, basically. They're up 10k of 30,000 gold teams, so.
Yeah.
Rather large lead for these guys. Evolved Wings comes out for Satan, so we'll get the resets off the kills if the team can find any.
It's a level 11 siege.
Yeah. Well, it's onto the inhibitor. Mid lane turret, there we go. It's gonna be down below one third. Ocelot staying for this one. Good damage comes through. He's gotta heal himself pretty soon. Top lane also seeded up JWoww and Morden, pulling Vanez around this one. Burns his ulti for that one. Javelin hits onto Sazed. And here we go. Attempt number 4. This could be the turret going down. There should be some good damage coming through. Nice bit of wave through there by Avenue, but the binding's going to hit. Good damage, the Javelin. Shantou tanks it for the teammate, actually. There comes the Lucian Q. Good damage going through still. And there's the push on in. Sazed takes another one, and these health bars are going lower and lower and lower. They finally go in for this one. That's going to be the inhibitor turret going down, and onto the inhib they go. 23 minutes in, looking great for Gamers 2.
Three below half there. Really living up to the name of what a siege comp is.
Mm-hmm.
No kills, but they ended up just picking them low enough, so they have to give up the objective.
And think about the timing here, speaking of objectives for Gamers 2. Dragon's up, Baron's in about 45 seconds. They can take Dragon, recall, heal up, buy some items, and then be at Baron in time. By the time super minions are pushing down the mid lane.
Oh, Morden, he's got a different objective in his sight.
Escape?
Straight over. But he gets a ward on the Baron.
Yeah!
Worth it.
And there we go. There's the recalls. 30 seconds till Baron. The heals, the items coming through. Gamers 2 now going to be fighting at full power. Death Cap is done for Ocelot, the Shiv, and now the Last Whisper is in there for Yuki. And now you've got two pieces of Trinity Force as well for JWoww. So this team is scary strong.
Satan clears out the ward that not worth anymore.
Nope.
Got out of there.
Give away 30 gold for that. Scumbag Morden.
That's how they're going to get back in the game, clearing the ward.
Hey, it's something.
No. But the way they would get back into this game is if they end up somehow stealing the Baron and getting a good fight off of it. but it'd be very hard because I don't know if they'd actually start the Baron up if Shantan Mach Vau is nearby. Instead, they would just poke them down until they can do it.
Yeah, well, they've got super minions as well to pull attention in the mid lane. This early on in the game, it takes a pretty good amount of effort for champions in general to fight off super minions.
Super minions are stronger than a champion in a one-on-one.
I feel like
at this point,
yeah, I think Lifesteal would maybe make Shantao win the 1v1 against the minion like heads up, but yeah, not exactly ideal. You see, so that was 3 points of his health right there. That's a death cap.
That minion pretty strong.
Pretty sure. Yep. Oh God! Wow. Good thing he life stole there. That guy was about to die.
Wow.
And out he goes. Yeah. So Shantae forced to run away. Yuki's going to push the bottom lane. This is good. Gamers 2 are split pushing the lanes to get them all pushing. So it's very easy for the team to move back and forth between the lanes that are important or simply turn onto Baron. You can see a lot of wards are down around the Baron pit. Satane's still waiting in the wings in the Fog of War. He's been trying for a while. Ward's going to spot him out there. Ward goes down. He knows about this. Q's going to land. Good damage comes through. Nice slow as well. Satane jumps the wall, but Morden's not done for this one. Wow, he landed the Q. Not going to go for it. They could just take Baron control right now. Looks like that will be the goal for this one. They've got to be careful not to get outspited by Satane, but that should be possible. There comes the attempt.
So they got him to half HP, and he blew his ultimate, and they saw that. So now, he's got a couple charges left. Nope, that's it. That was it.
All right, Rocket Force. There's the wards coming down. The Vine's going to hit Satane. They're going to execute him and take him down real quick before they come back into this one. Ward's going to ward hop back over. That will guarantee them now the Baron. I don't see a way for Shantae Mach Vau to steal this one, so it's going to be Baron number 2, 25 minutes, 50 seconds into the game, and they can now go for Siege Attempt number 2.
Jude and Morden have been coming up big this game. The catches that they're able to create, and now go for the flash.
Ooh, the stun's going to land the Q as well. Kill picked up. That's 2 dead. And Gamers 2 can keep pushing, and they've still got super minions in the mid lane to make this push happen. Vanez has the teleport, but he's got to recall him back and defend with his team of 5 versus 4, and the base is about to be dying.
They're trying to defend it. Morden taking some turret shots there. Once again, the siege is up. The Nidalee so scary with the damage he has accumulated.
Well, there goes the engage, though. JWoww's going to look for it. Saves gets stunned up, but now onto the inhibitor to go. The turret's already gone. Low health on Satane still. It's a 5v5 only now as the respawn's coming through, but it's 2 inhibitors dead. Mid lane respawning about now. They're going to make sure they clear away the minions in this one and see if they're going to get anything else off of this one, but they right now ping at the bottom lane. This team taking their time to close the game out, not wanting to 5v5 under turrets.
They want to just pick them apart.
Oop. Q's going to land. They knew the inhib was coming back up, so they waited for that one instead. Top lane is going to start spawning supers very, very soon. Again, 5-on-5 should be safe for Gamers 2. They don't need to back off. Good Black Shield keeps Yuki safe. Ocelot can heal back up anyway. More spam coming through. Good damage goes through. Look at that one. Low health bars now on the mid laners. They're going to move in half HP now on the inhibitor. Hook's going to be dodged, and that's going to be inhib number 2.
Satane taking a lot of damage there. If one of those had crit...
Yeah, that's true. When I crit, there's a good chance he goes down. Not the case just yet, though. And again, the minions still dying off. They've got JWoww now finally split pushing in the bottom lane to set this lane up for the team. Gamers 2 just have to wait until this wave reaches, then close the game out.
Haven't been a lot of teleports this game.
No.
At all.
I haven't seen any.
Yeah.
Maybe back to lane, but that's it.
Back to lane is pretty much it. People teleporting into the fights wasn't really happening for the most part. So it's just been split pushing by Gamers 2.
Finding on Vanez. Good damage comes through. That Q might have gotten the execute there if at least they wanted to go. But here comes the first siege. 20 seconds on the next wave. Vortigern gets hooked. They don't care about that, though. Top lane, big wave.
Oh,
Avenir gets kicked back in. He's going to be going down. Nice play by Morden. Set that one up. And now the inhibitor going to be under fire. They will be doing some good damage. But Satane is around. They've got to be a little bit careful. Looks like they're going to have enough. JWoww also forcing him away. Yuki not quite finding the kill. But down goes the actual Kha'Zix finally. Does go down. Avenue already dead. Third inhibitor going to fall as well. JWoww gets hooked in, gets Black Shielder. He goes in for the fight anyway. The CC on his Saze. There's the third kill this fight. Shantao going to get jumped back onto the fountain. Vana's losing health as well. It's going to be the Nexus turrets going down. It's going to be the 2-0. Just under 30 minutes. And Gamers 2 going to make their way into the semifinals.
Previously, it was off the back of Ocelot. Now, it's off the back of Morden and Dude, who played with confidence this game.
Yes.
From start to finish. Still deathless bottom lane here for Gamers 2. They're going to be going up against Freeze and Mythi and IP in a couple weeks.
and they added 20 to their KDA that game. 9 for the AD carry, 11 for the support overall. And they came into that game with, what, 81? I believe the
very,
KDA.
Very close.
So I think that actually let us crest 100 KDA for the bottom lane so far in the Challenger Series, still deathless. Because game one was like a good like 40 or something. It was a good number of kills.
Yeah, they came in with 51 combined between them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
and then
you're about
30-ish.
You're right.
From game one in this series.
You're
so,
right. So
I'm pretty certain at the very least, and they get some point during their first semifinal game, they can get that score at the very least. But
unless they just die twice straight off,
level 1-2 deaths, and they ruin the dream at like 99. Like watch it happen, and I'm like wrong on the map.
Might actually be above 100 already.
I think it is.
ADA
I think it is. Yeah. So obviously phenomenal play there. Gamers 2 looked a lot sharper that game. I liked the siege comp. They played it really well. The picks they made, Morden made a whole bunch of good moves. As you said, Diude as well made a bunch of good moves. And then it's like 50 minutes, they're like,
yeah.
Top lane, turret, turret, mid lane, turret, bottom lane, turret. Like, just blasted the game open. 16-minute Baron as well. Like, great, great decision-making to say, we can take this, we can take that, we can take that.
Well, they knew what they could take. They had felt out Chantal MacDeVal for so long in the first game. 52 minutes. This one, almost half that at 29. Fixed a lot of their problems. Morden showed up. Diude is just informed they have a 96 KDA instead of 100. They're very close. They're very close.
The pressure's on.
100 KDA, the dream for the bot lane.
100 KDA, the dream. I got to say, that'd be a good one. But sorry, continue to the point, though.
My point was that Morden and Diude played with confidence this game, and they carried it. If they could enter all the games like that in the future, they can set up and be facilitators for their team.
Yeah. And Morden, consistently, I went and looked at the team on the rank 5s ladder, all their games so far. He is tunneling on Lee Sin really hard. He wants to make those individual plays. You saw so many kickbacks and priority targets. He got Avenue killed in that late game siege. He's got a lot of picks for his teams overall. Now, the thing is, that's not available if you force Lee Sin's flashes out by making aggressive moves.
Yeah. Right?
You deny a lot of these opportunities for Morden to make these plays if you can actually exert some pressure there. Morden didn't counter jungle crazy heavily. He just looked for gank opportunities.
He did in the first game. The first game, completely different.
When they were spotted, though, right? Like,
yeah.
Like he's doing reactive counter jungling where he's like, okay, you were bot lane, but I didn't counter gank that, so I'll take away Wraiths. Like, I want to know how much Gamers 2 can be proactive, right? Can take advantages for themselves and say, based on just what we sort of know about your playstyle, based on where we think you are, we can go for this. Almost everything they're doing is still kind of a reaction to what their opponents give them.
I'm a little excited and a little worried for Morden. He's going to be up against Ko.
Yeah.
Who plays Lee Sin just like him, but not just like him.
Yeah.
Plays
arguably better.
Completely different. Plays extremely aggressive.
Hyper aggro.
Hyper aggression in that. And these two teams, I believe they've played each other back.
Yeah. Spring 2, I believe.
Spring 2.
Spring 2 quarterfinals.
Yeah. It was very, very, very.
It was 2-1 NIP, if I remember correctly.
Yeah. But now the NIP has changed their style.
Mm-hmm.
To be hyper-aggressive in the early game, can this late-game team do something about that?
I wonder. You know, I want to see how these guys match up. It'll be a fun battle when these guys meet. Well, tonight's quarterfinal matchup is in the books, so here's what the updated challenger bracket looks like. With their win, Gamers 2 is advancing to the semifinals, where they will face the Ninjas in Pajamas.
And next week, we'll find out who ends up in the other semifinal match up against Denial Esports when Denial Esports goes up against Lublin Shore on Thursday, June 5th. Then, on Friday, June 6th, the former Cloud9 Eclipse returns to Challenger as H2K Gaming, and they will take on SK Gaming Prime.
Oh, it's going to be a fun matchup. All these games throughout the week is going to be good. These teams are getting better and better overall. But before then, there's more LCS action on the way. Tomorrow, the North American LCS kicks off Summer Split Week 2. It all starts at 9 p.m. Central European Summer Time, 12 p.m. Pacific Daylight Time. That's going to start with Counter Logic Gaming taking on Team Solo Mid. Then Complexity goes up against Evil Geniuses.
Then LMQ battles Team Dignitas, followed by Cloud9 against Curse.
And the North American Challenger Summer 1 quarterfinals gets underway when XDG takes on Frank Fang Gaming in a best-of-3 matchup. For the complete schedule of games, head on over to lolesports.com. Now with that, we've reached the end of our time together tonight. But before we go, I want to say thanks again to our friends at Coca-Cola. Now for myself, Zyrene, and the entire wonderful live broadcast crew, thanks for watching, good night, and GG. We'll be right back.